Welcome back to all the participants, the listeners. Right, the first session has got one lecture. The lecture is about the tangible and intangible maritime heritage by two research associates of the Maritime History Society, Ms. Amrita Talwadekar and Ms. Aishwarya Devasthali. So let me introduce the speakers to the audience and the participants. Ms. Amrita Talwadekar is an architect by profession, a master's degree in architecture and urban conservation from Kamala Raheja Vijayanidhi Institute for Architecture and Environmental Studies. She has been working with the Maritime History Society Mumbai since July 2019. Looking into the research and conservation of the built heritage lying within the maritime domain. Living in Mumbai, her keen interest lies in the maritime history of Mumbai. Being an enthusiast and a technical professional, she is inclined towards the shipbuilding practices and techniques of India. Now let me introduce the second speaker, Ms. Aishwarya Vivek Devasthali. She is an archaeologist by profession, having interest in history, culture, tourism, and arts. She has completed a master's in ancient Indian history, culture, and archaeology from Deccan College, Postgraduate and Research Institute, Pune in 2017. After her post-graduation for 2 years, she has worked in the Archaeological Survey of India, a premier organization for archaeological research and protection of the cultural heritage of the nation as an archaeologist. Currently, she is associated with the Maritime History Society as a project research associate. So I welcome both of you young ladies for this talk, and it's over to you for the presentation. Please go ahead.
Thank you, sir. So very good morning to one and all. I would like to start with this quote today. I read this the other day, and it said, "It is not the honor you take with you, but the heritage you leave behind." And I think that's what we are here to share today. So before we begin, let us talk about heritage. While heritage can be a broader concept, it can be termed as anything that has been inherited from past, something that possesses a high value, be it historic, cultural, architectural, emotional. It gives us a sense of belongingness and something that you pass on to your next generation or future generations. And it is very interesting to know what we call heritage in our languages. May it be virasat, amcha varsa, parampara, hamari dharohar. And that's how we come to know meaning of heritage in our own language. So with this, let's talk about maritime heritage. So what if I told you that everything you see in the coming images is part of maritime heritage? I'll show some images and I want all of us to think about it from lens of maritime heritage. So next slide. So it may be a cuisine, then built structures, festival. So as you see, India's maritime heritage is spread across in its art, architecture, languages, music, science, nautical knowledge, religion, and philosophy, and astronomy, among the many. Thus, it can be further divided into tangible and intangible heritage, both being found in abundance. So, tangible maritime heritage of India includes the material traces, including archaeological sites, monuments like forts, batteries, or any artifacts. While intangible heritage includes tradition, living expressions inherited from our ancestors and passed on to our descendants, such as oral traditions, occupational practices, navigational knowledge, and traditional crafts. So today we will look at just three representative aspects. And the first one is intangible heritage with a case reference of shipbuilding at Mandvi. The second one is built heritage along the western coast through few forts. And the third is just a short overview of journey of maritime archaeology in India. So now I would request Amrita Talwadekar to deal with our first topic, that is intangible heritage, shipbuilding. Over to you, Amrita.
So here we'll talk about the shipbuilding heritage. India is a land of rich culture and heritage. With its history dating back to almost 5,000 years, India has been a mosaic of traditions, practices, festivals, communities, craft, and livelihood, knowledge, which has been passed on from generations to generations. With a vast coastline spanning across its three sides, India has been a maritime country. The geographical position of India has always been very advantageous and has enhanced the country's maritime dominance. Its geographical location within the Indian Ocean has led to its predominance among the other nearby countries. Ships have often been catalysts for securing trade links, exchange of culture, and supporting warfare at sea. From reed boats to massive vessels that you see today, shipbuilding in India has seen its highs and lows with aggressive growth and sharp decline through time. So you see, Indians were closely related to the maritime medium from as early as the prehistoric age. The overseas trade was only possible through a vast knowledge of the sea. The excavations in 1955 at Lothal, Gujarat, signify the existence of a land of a water-based craft for travel and a dock facility for its maintenance. The Rig Vedas also have excerpts where it says nav, which was used to cross the Samudra. So there were also some ancient Tamil texts that mention the Muzuri's port, which is often visited by the Greek and the Roman ships for trade purposes. After they realized that sailing through the Red Sea to the Horn of Africa led to the Kerala coast. But prior to the arrival of the Europeans, when the Arabs ruled or dominated the region, the shipbuilding craft eventually saw a significant change and rise. The Arabs were seafarers who began to come to India for trading purposes starting from the 7th century. There was durable timber available in abundance. There was a large coastline to suffice the craft. There was cheap labor. And the region being on the key trade routes was obviously advantageous. The ships began to be constructed in wood. Communities began to be recognized for their physical strength and capacity to construct and repair the vessels. The Marathas, under the rule of Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj, constructed shipbuilding and ship maintenance yards into the inland at a sufficient distance from the river or the creek beyond the reach of the tidal waters. When the Portuguese established their colonies in India, they realized the great quality of timber and the high quality construction, which was the reason the Indian ships lasted long, and they declared wood as a luxury in India. When the British Empire set their foothold in India, they appointed the English East India Company to look into their whereabouts. Bombay soon emerged as a major shipbuilding hub. They invited the Wadia master shipbuilders, who were known in this field, to settle in Bombay from Gujarat. Several massive ships made out of wood were constructed thereafter. As the traders began to make Indian-made vessels, the European shipbuilders began protesting the use of these vessels. Gradually, the Indians and European merchants preferred European crafts over Indian vessels due to the changing rules and regulations of trade at sea and the ability to provide security against piracy. They termed Indian goods as inferior to let down the people, even while the craft was known for its superior quality. Further, with the advent of steam and steel, these handcrafted vessels lost its importance and the craft gradually declined. So I happened to have visited Mandvi, which is in Gujarat, in India, after I joined the Maritime History Society. So after probing in detail, I found out that there were several boat forms that were inspired by the place of origin. So So places like Mandvi, Gujarat, and Bepur in Kerala continue to practice this type of indigenous shipbuilding even today. So I would like to share some of my research that I've been doing on the Mandvi boatyard. So Mandvi is a strategically important town located in Gujarat on the banks of River Rukmati. Due to its position on the various trade routes that linked Africa, the Gulf and the Makran coast, it has historically been a town of boatmakers, ship fishermen and merchants. The evident boat building tradition here goes back to almost 800 years. It has been a family oriented and a community oriented tradition, driven with passion, hard work, and excellence of skills and imagination. The Kharwas and the Badhalas are talented boat builders of this region who have resided here since the early times. So you see the creek, the Rukmati River, which is now a creek. Today, a magnificent view of boats being built is a delight to the eye. Boat building is just not a craft, but a way of living for the residents. The boats at Mandvi are built completely in wood. Initially, a detailed blueprint is prepared. Prior to the actual construction of the vessel, a miniature model is made of the exact, from the same material, but of a smaller size to check the strength and stability of the boat. The budget is then decided and the vessels are made as per the budget and the requirement from the purchaser. The width, as you can see, of the ship is generally one third of its length in order to procure stability. This design involves boats without a mast. The construction of a boat is a tedious task and takes almost 2 to 2.5 years to construct a massive vessel. It almost costs around 2 crores. There are no drawings and the skill is fixed in their heads. The craft is passed on from one generation to the other. The younger craftsmen are brought up and educated in the actual workshop and are trained under the father or any elderly person. There is no technical education in the world that can compete with the hands-on experience that the next generation receives from the previous generation. In the workshop, the technique is learned from the beginning and in relation to real things and experiences that the previous generation has experienced. So the boat building, so you see in your image, the changing pattern of land while the boat is being constructed and post flag off. So the boat is constructed entirely on a silted land on the Rukmati River. The Kutch Gazetteer, as I was going through the files, records that except during floods, the part close to the town, that is the creek, was dry, sandy, and could easily be crossed at low tide. The town is known to have been deep. The creek is known to have been that deep so that it could allow vessels of almost 70 tons to go almost 500 yards within the town during springtime. Nowadays, the region experiences very little rainfall, due to which the yards are open throughout the year. So once the boat is completed, the land beneath the water, the boat is dug up using minimal machinery. This is generally done prior to Purnima using indigenous techniques, after which the water level rises. And that's when once the water level comes to a adequate standard, the boat is flagged off. So you can see an image where there is a boat and this is post flag off. So earlier the wood used to be procured from Bangalore and Ahmedabad. These were so now currently it's procured from Malaysia as well as Gujarat. There are two types of wood that is used. One is sal wood and the other is babul wood. So these are some of the tools that are used by these craftsmen. It includes nuts and bolts, wooden pegs to fix the nuts and bolts without damaging the timber, and a machine that you see here, which is used to split the logs. all these machines are also made indigenously at the yard. So the process starts by cutting and drying the wood in the sun. The keel is the base is actually prepared first. A large single wood, which is called pathan in the local language, is laid at the start, following which a frame made out of wood that you can see in this image is created to form its shape. Large planks are then gently bent over fire and chiseled into shape and fixed together. The bending process involves application of mud on the planks, heating, and then bending the wood. The craftsmen use anchors to bend the wood into the required shape. The patia, which forms the third layer, is the outer skin of the vessel. All of this is perfectly filled together, and the gaps are filled using wooden planks, which are then filled in with a particular type of indigenous sealant. So you can see in this image that there is cotton dipped in vegetable oil, and that's how they make the vessel watertight. And it is called lapa in the local language. You can see a worker doing that. Horizontal planks are then laid out to create the deck of the boat. As per the demands from the purchaser, cabins are made from wood and assembled. So it depends what type of ship it is, what type of requirements the purchaser has. Does he require more storage? And it is made accordingly. The last layer involves 2 to 3 coats of anti-fouling paint to give the external body a magnificent finish. It also makes the vessel watertight and rust-free. The boat is flagged off to the purchaser with a local engine, who then fits a world-class engine to it and modifies it as per his choice. The craft has demands from Qatar and other Saudi Arabian countries who use the boat for transport and tourism. For them, having a boat is a status symbol. Currently, over the years, with the upgradation in material from wood to steel and in technology, the demand for wooden hand-constructed boats has gradually declined. When I and my colleague had went to Mandvi, we realized that once upon a time, that region had almost 30 orders in a year. But now they have reduced it to as less as 2 to 3 orders a year. Today also, with the rise in water pollution at Mandvi, there has been arrival of small insects in the river water. These insects begin to wear out the wood and create holes within the wood, which has started to decompose the wooden members. This has also reduced the life of the vessel and has caused a concern for the craftsmen. The wooden nails have been replaced by metal nails that rust very easily, and it adds to the maintenance of the boat. As per the locals, the lack of subsidy or schemes from the government has led to the depletion of the traditional craft. As per the Anti-Piracy Act issued in 2010, these types of vessels are banned from going south of Oman, leading to a slow decline. These vessels often become targets to Somalian pirates, and which has led to more stricter rules for licensing of the ship. So this form of intangible cultural heritage is under threat right now. It's endangered by globalization and cultural homogenization, and by the lack of support, appreciation, and understanding. With this decline and no foreseen scope for progress and income generation, the younger generation is now moving out of these areas and the profession in search of new opportunities. The older generation thus fears to be the last one to carry on the vast inherited knowledge without being able to impart it further. The craft is historically rich in terms of its knowledge and practice and needs to be conserved for the future generations. Let me now hand over to Aishwarya to take you through the built heritage within the maritime domain. Over to you, Aishwarya.
thank you. So I am really fascinated to know that the vessels are an object of reverence and are worshipped by the coastal communities and seafaring communities, and they possess a high material value in their lives. So thank you, Amruta, for sharing this first-hand information about this living heritage we all have. It is noteworthy that the material culture speaks volumes about man and his life, and that is the reason why we archaeologists and heritage enthusiasts treasure it. So I must say, we don't dig up past, but we dig out our people and apparently our roots, our lives of our ancestors. And this is how we can come to our next segment, that is tangible heritage. So this is in today's trending thing, like art and artists. I must say, the image you saw earlier, it was of Fort Raigad, the capital of Marathas. And I was one of the artists who excavated that residential structure. So I would first like to talk about how I got marinized into the maritime dimension of history in general and with sea and coastal forts in particular. So 2 years back, I was just having some study time in library and taking notes on national monuments. And just for curiosity, I was going through some chronicles belonging to medieval period. And I came across this fabulous piece named Chitragupta Bakhar, which records story of construction of Fort Sindhudurg. So Bakhar is basically a form of historical narrative written in prose, and these can be called as one of the earliest genres in medieval Marathi literature, chronicling the deeds of great Maratha ruler Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj. And now this takes us to our core topic for today, that is forts. So fort settlements have always been or remained as an important asset to military system of every strong dynastic order. So their evidence dates back to prehistoric period, where we have examples from sites like Kot Diji and all. And as early medieval period was the period of political upheaval in Indian history, the rulers and chieftains had wars amongst them for supremacy. So in early medieval period, sea was a medium of trade and commerce, and its connection with fort can be understood through the text, that is Manasara Shilpa Shastra, which mentions that a town or fort should be built near river or water body. It should have a facility of trade and commerce with foreigners. This highlights the importance of importance of forts in trade and economy since centuries, I must say. So thus one gets reference of water forts in ancient texts, which highlight the knowledge of importance of water bodies and concept of such a built structure within it. A sea route directly connecting Europe to India came into limelight when Vasco da Gama, Portuguese explorer, came to Calicut. This made India the center of attention of Europe's trade circuit, and European powers rushed to Asia to get their own trading posts. Even though the primary motive at first was trade, slowly European powers started to get more interested in annexation of territory. The British, Dutch, Portuguese, and other powers were few of these powers looking for monetary gains and rule. And this is how the concept of usage of sea for trade and commerce changed into connectivity, competition, conflict, and resulting in fortifications, annexations, and exhibition of sea power. So the game of competition and conflict with territorial acquisitions amongst colonial powers created an alarming situation for indigenous rulers, and thus built defense structures like forts were used by them as a tool to counter colonial influence and keeping a safe sway over the land. Marathas pioneered the thought of building powerful navy on western coast and thus erected and strengthened some forts along Konkan coast. So Marathas developed a potent naval force and defeated the rivals like British, Siddhis, and Portuguese, and proved superiority over Konkan, which was a land of utmost importance for being a link between Desh and Arabian Sea since ancient period. So when one talks about powerful administration, defense, and navy, one can get an idea of how a well-located and differently designed fort plays its role in economy, politics, and society of any region. And here comes the role of coastal and sea forts. So the islands on western coast are made up of rocks, making it favorable for erection of fortifications. And thus, most of the island forts on western coast are fortified. To understand this in greater detail, we have taken case studies of forts, namely Fort Khanderi and Fort Sindhudurg. Also, I would like to mention Fort Diu to understand how colonial influence was there. The first approach I discussed. So Fort Diu is an island. Diu is basically an island located slightly off Kathiawad coast of Gujarat at the mouth of Gulf of Kanwe in western India. The island was under the reign of various kingdoms like Chalukyas, Kshatrapas, Maitrakas, Chavdas, Mahmud Ghazni and Waghela Rajputs. Although the town fell into hands of many rulers, it emerged as an important mercantile hub mainly in 15th century. So under Sultans of Gujarat, Diu emerged as an important trading port with its connections spanning across Africa and Arabia. The Portuguese rule at Diu would obviously mean a tighter control on maritime activities and to and from the heart of Gujarat. The naturally excellent harbor was of course an added advantage. After the siege of Diu, the Gujarat Sultanate never rose up again. The fortress of Diu, along with its town, rose up to become the second biggest financial contributor, remained with Portuguese Empire till 1961, till it came under Indian government after Operation Vijay. The fort of Diu was thus an eyewitness to several battles that took place for establishment of colonial influence at the sea. Now we come to Konkan coast to sail through the second approach which I discussed earlier, that is the indigenous approach. So the first fort is Fort Khanderi, and Khanderi is a small island near the entrance of Bombay Harbour, south of Bombay. So Bombay in 17th to 18th century was a growing trade center, and it was very important to keep British in check. So the Khanderi fort, if you see very carefully, it gave an opportunity to keep an eye on Mumbai, which is located at the north, and also to keep check on expansion of Siddhis, which was happening from south towards northern Konkan. So the northeast side of the island was already protected from the wind, affording good landing for ships. Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj, a sound strategist, sent 300 soldiers and as many laborers with arms and materials to Khanderi and immediately began to raise breastworks and at the landing places. On hearing about Shivaji's construction at Khanderi, English claimed ownership over the island. And English ordered Shivaji's killedar, Mainak Bhandari, to give up the island, but he refused. And they were not able to prevent Marathas from strengthening forces on Khanderi. So the Marathas' boats kept passing at night, cannons were mounted on island, an armed battle took place, and three English officers were killed. The ships were captured by Marathas. Later, the Siddhi and Mughal admiral joined English with a strong fleet. The fight went on, but to no purpose, and Siddhis continued to batter Khanderi, but then they gave up and built Underi, the sister fort near Khanderi. The Marathas, by giving tough fight to Portuguese, English and Siddhis, finally completed building the fort. In 1693, Khafi Khan is said to have mentioned Khanderi as the strongest of Shivaji's newly built forts on the seashore. And later in 1713, Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj, Shahu Maharaj, gave control of the fort to Kanhoji Angre. And he is said to have made Khanderi as the naval base to give a tough fight to competitors. And finally, after 139 years of tough competition and fights, British finally marched over Khanderi. They succeeded and took fort under their charges in 1818 and renamed it as Fort Khanderi. And now we talked about this built heritage, but there is some unique tradition happening there. So some unique community practice taking place at the fort. This also suggests the need for documentation, promoting intangibility hidden behind this tangible monument. And to say it here, after one gets down at the main gate of the fort, a small wooden temple, it is known as Vetar Temple. So here devotees, especially they are the fishermen, they offer the back of shark fish to the deity. And he is said to control waves, he is said to control, believed to rule waves. And that is the reason why he is prayed there or worshipped there. And this is something very unique, practice I went through or I saw, I read. Also, one cannot miss the presence of 150-year-old lighthouse on the fort, which itself, I think, offers a beautiful example of a modern maritime structure on a maritime monument. So let's move to Fort Sindhudurg. Yes, it is the jewel of sea. It is an extensively built fort and the coastal capital of Marathas, very near to coast of Malwa Bay on Kurte Island. So the fort was built on orders of Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj. Malwan, being an important port since centuries, it was blessed with strategic location or strategic importance. It is called as the 15th jewel gifted by the sea in Chitragupta Bakhar, the Pandhave Ratna. In the middle of 16th century, Shivaji Maharaj is said to have surveyed the coastline and fixed Malwan with its rocky island and roof-blocked harbour as his coastal headquarters. With the best protection for his vessels and the likeliest place for being a stronghold, Malwan was a good choice considering he was subject to constant failures from acquiring Janjira from the Siddhis. He is said to have personally involved in construction of the fort according to all the chronicles which I went. And this massive fortress is the most formidable and the best preserved one till date in coastal forts of Maharashtra. So the area of fort is 48 acres in foundation stones laid down in slots and molten lead was poured to fix them firmly. When Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj came to Rajapur for the first time, he minutely examined the various rocks locked in water. This can be seen in the picture here. So he called the fishermen of the place and gathered from them all details for making way towards the island. And it was difficult to approach the island except with a zigzag serpentine passage through which only small ships could make a way and large ships could have no access to it. And this is how where I think community knowledge or the navigational knowledge plays its role, the traditional knowledge which the fishermen had. So, and the reef-blocked Malwan had been a bad hub. So Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj might have chosen this place for Sindhudurga Fort, knowing its geographical features very well. It remained in hands of indigenous rulers till end. The British expedition was sent against Sindhudurga for Sindhudurga. The fort was captured, intending to keep it. It was named as Fort Augustus. But as it was very hard to dismantle the fort, it was given back to the Kolhapur chief, who were the descendants later. This shows how Fort Sindhudurga stood strong, giving a tough fight to colonial powers. Today, the fort is highly revered due to presence of temple of Shivaji Maharaj and the footprints here. So there is here we can see the emotional value attached with the fort. And now we come to our next segment, which is the maritime archaeology and a journey of India's maritime archaeology, rather. And now let's just think of extensive Indian coastline of about 7,500 of kilometers, having a long and well-established history of ports and centers with extensive maritime trade networks. Moreover, the Indian Peninsula occupies the all-important geographic center of old world maritime trade routes connecting the east and the west, often acting as the catalyst for the movement of commerce and culture. So the contact between Indian subcontinent and the west through maritime activities has been traced back to early as 3rd millennium before common era, with cultural material including Harappan seals and semi-precious stones like lapis lazuli being found at Mesopotamia and Egypt. So one of the initial forays into coastal archaeology stemmed from an overspill of the fervor with which Buddhist archaeology was practiced in 19th century. So the excavation of the stupa at Sopara and recovery of ancillary artifacts by Bhagwan Lal Indraji was one of the earliest attempts of course, an unintentional one, at investigating site in proximity to an ancient port. However, the wealth of information that such sites preserve sparked the interest in systematic archaeology of old sites along the coast as early in 1940 as exemplified by the excavation at Arikamedu by Mortimer Wheeler, Sir Mortimer Wheeler. Subsequently, the preliminary explorations revealed a large number of such sites along both the west coast and east coast of India, ranging in the date from protohistoric period to as recent as the 18th century and 19th century. Some of these sites, such as Harappan site of Lothal, the early historic site of Muziris, or the early medieval sites of Chol and Sanjan, were excavated, and while they provided much perspective about history of these time periods, a vast amount of data set still remains incomplete or lies incomplete. While the evidence procured thus far has been subterranean, it is the submarine evidence from submerged sites and shipwrecks that it is the vital key in unlocking that elusive reasons for or is elusive picture or complete picture or a bit more. It is for this and all the aforementioned reasons that the scope of underwater archaeology has a huge potential. It has tremendous potential, and we have a lot of scope to work on it. So following the excavations at Harappan site of Lothal, Gujarat, between 1953 and 64, the discovery of the earliest tidal docks ever recorded, there was an invigorated interest in India's underwater and marine maritime heritage, especially in form of submerged and sunken ships, submerged cities and sunken ships. So the pioneering work and contributions of eminent archaeologists, the SRA, I have put picture here, is synonymous with the birth of underwater archaeology movement in India. His efforts resulted in initiation of Marine Archaeology Center in 1981 under the aegis of National Institute of Oceanography, Goa. That the underwater archaeology in India was given importance during 1980s is substantiated by the fact that it is included in the country's 6th 5-year plan. With a focus of traditional navigation and shipbuilding technology, the Center of Underwater Archaeology at Tamil University, Thanjavur, set up by UGC in 1983, retrieved a number of iron and stone anchors of Tamil coast. So these initial efforts resulted in launching of training programs and conferences dedicated to marine archaeology, as well as offshore and onshore explorations. This ultimately culminated in the establishment of underwater archaeology wing of Archaeological Survey of India by Dr. Alok Tripathi in 2001. And that, in addition to few universities located near a number of submerged coastal cities and shipwrecks, and carried out explorations and excavations along the east and west coast of India. So apart from the documentation of offshore coastal and shipwreck sites, as well as training archaeologists to undertake such explorations, one of the initial mandates of Indian Underwater Archaeology Wing was to preserve and protect underwater cultural heritage. So till date, underwater archaeological explorations have been taken, or explorations and excavations have been carried out at Dwarka, Bet Dwarka, Somnath, Vijaydurg, Malwand, Goa, Lakshadweep Islands, Kumpuhar, and Mahabalipuram waters. Onshore and nearshore explorations have also been carried out at Machilipatnam, Rameshwaram, Coast, Calicut, Bepur, Mangalore, Honavar, Bhatkal, Ratnagiri, Dabhol, Chol, Janjiran, there are many places. So we hope to get usually huge finds, but usually we get these potsherds and things. So despite some, next slide please. And this is just a glimpse of sea wealth which lies beneath the waters. And there is huge such number of artifacts found or not, and they are preserved. And this, despite some respectable work carried out during its nearly 4 decades of consideration, underwater archaeology in India still remains nascent, especially when compared to the strides made by fields or countries like Americas, Europe, and Oceania. There is need to generate awareness and establish a dialogue between experts, stakeholders, and scholars alike to address these key concerns and discuss future scope of Indian underwater archaeology. So I would request Amruta to share our concluding remarks. Thank you.
Thus, heritage, both tangible and intangible, is a legacy of physical property and intangible qualities by a community or a civilization that are retained by the previous generation and should be preserved for the good of the future generation. Humans have forever been avid explorers in search of basic essentials for survival and for livelihood. With the increase in explorations, they began taking over the surrounding areas to expand their scope and possibilities towards survival. Sea and coastal forts thus became seaward sentinels and an eyewitness to the explorations and annexations across time. Forts thus played a crucial role in shaping an evolution of these settlements. With the growing seaborne travel, shipbuilding and the allied activities eventually rose around the coastal regions. From handmade reed boats to massive ocean-going vessels, the indigenous shipbuilding industry has seen an influence of cultural exchange across time. The inhabitants across civilizations and ruling periods have understood and adopted various sea tactics and designed and redesigned their vessels and its amenities based on their experiences. Today, even though the craft lies in an inconspicuous corner of few towns in the country, the rich value of this craft has been an integral part of the past and needs to be conserved for the future. Marine archaeology, on the other hand, is a vast subject that involves dealing with the wider aspect of ocean and sea. Also, since preservation of the things that lie deep in the ocean bed is equally important, it becomes relevant to note that the responsibility of a marine archaeologist becomes even tougher. Each and every scope of the ocean bed is covered by marine archaeologists when it comes to excavation and finding of important details and data. As an archaeology program, marine archaeology is not just interesting, but alluring and is a profession of utmost significance and relevance. Thus, forts, handmade craft like shipbuilding, and components of maritime archaeology are an integral and important part of our history, and their ruins are our priceless heritage. They are also a great testimony of the fact that we were a sea power and we knew how to navigate into and protect our seas. With the change in strategies, with the advent of new material and technology, and the lack of awareness, India's priceless heritage is on the verge of extinction. Indeed, if Earth is said to have been born 4.5 billion years ago, then the topics that we've covered are just few pieces of a jigsaw put together from the vast treasure of knowledge hidden within the maritime domain. From prehistoric times till date, a sea or an ocean forms an indispensable part of our lives and a huge secret keeper of the past civilization. And thus, this segment of heritage offers a huge scope to connect globally and celebrate the common and shared heritage, and to look back and have a better future ahead. However, as students of maritime history, we appeal to continue to explore into the heritage of ancient, medieval, and pre-modern times, evaluated in context that will yield results and lessons and will give a fresh focus in the coming years. We urge you to read more, write more, and publish more on the various aspects lying within the maritime domain. Let's all come together to enhance our maritime consciousness. Thank you. we'll now be open for any questions that we get.
Thank you, Lilis, for the wonderful presentation. What I will do now is this part of the session, we will have some concluding remarks from Commander Johnson after some time. While we take some questions, any questions from the panelists who are on the meeting room? If there are no questions from the panelists, I'll have some questions from probably some students who have raised one or two questions, and then I'll ask some questions myself. Any of the panelists want to ask any questions? Yokuranda sir, Padmashree madam, Kesildev, anybody? Right. What I'll do is, there are some questions posed by probably some students. One, Mr. Rishabh Jain is asking, to share some references further to read. I think he's been inspired. So probably we'll have to give out some books or some kind of literature he can read. Can we do that later on? Aishwarya? Can unmute yourself? Johnson, and
speak. Is Johnson sir speaking?
No, Aishwarya, I want you to answer. Mr. Rishabh Jain is asking.
So references regarding forts, you mean?
Whatever about all this topic, he was inspired probably, and he says share some references.
Yeah, I think Amruta can guide more on shipbuilding and references about that. But about forts, I must say a lot of work has been done, but it is done written in Marathi. So that itself is a task for us to go through and to bring this knowledge ahead. But to talk about some really good works, the one work is done by M.S. Naravane sir. So he has surveyed coastal line, complete coastline from west coast to east coast, and he has documented each and every fort with good templates. So that can be the most initial book to go about or to talk about. And then there are many, but there is one book that by MHS publication itself. It's Maritime and Coastal Forts of India. Even that book is written by Ms. Naravane sir. So initial books are these two books I would say to refer.
Okay. Then there is another question from one Priya Agarwal. Very interesting question. This, what are the factors which pose danger to the maritime heritage? Are we in danger of losing this heritage, and what are the factors which are posing danger to the maritime heritage?
Sir Ramesh, can I come in here?
Please, madam, go ahead.
I've been listening to this. I have actually visited these one site at least, Mandvi. Now, the history has it that soon after independence, in order to preserve the heritage, the government of India had actually reserved certain trajectories and certain cargo for these ships. For example, all dates, khajur, to be imported from Iran was to be imported only through these wooden ships. And this went on for many years till the liberalization of the economy, when they said, now you have to start competing. So they were very comfortable just importing these dates and other things, on reserved items, on reserved routes. Now there is reservation of routes and no reservation of cargo. So they, and it's very, very difficult for them to compete. That is one. Also, it's basically policy support. Second thing is international, maritime organizations, conventions also. they apply only to the modern scientifically constructed boats. Now, these people who construct these boats, they don't have engineering degree. They are not graduates. Sometimes some of them have not gone beyond fourth standard. We have to recognize their skill. If you look at formal English, Western oriented degrees, then there is a problem because they will not be in compliance with any of the conventions of IMO, ILO, etc. But if you look at their skills, they far outweigh the skills that we are giving in modern educational institutions. So that is another big challenge. How do we recognize their skills? They will not be able to do any engineering. They will not be, they will not be able to talk any modern engineering. But they are constructing the ship. Interestingly, I don't know whether Aishwarya or Amrita actually touched upon this. They have not had a single accident in the 50 to 70 years since independence that they've been functioning. They have their own regulations, internal regulations, by which they take a ship, these wooden ships, off the seas for regular maintenance once in so many years. They make sure that they are maintained, they are repaired, because their life depends on it. Otherwise they're still sailing from the west coast of India to certain Middle East countries. They're still sailing. And India is the only country that I know of which actually recognizes these wooden boats. And there's a separate chapter in the National Shipping Act of 1958 that says, regulation of wooden ships. So there is no other country, and if we lose it, it's gone. The rest of the world, you will have only wooden fishing boats here and there, but not really long sea and, sea-going ships. So these are the two main things. How do we ensure? And the third, of course, is if there is no policy support, and if there is no support from the international, if the international conventions are not helping them, then obviously they will have to abandon and send their children to, other professions. So this is a challenge. But let me tell you what we are missing by not talking to them or not being inclusive about them. I was in Cochin a long time back, many years ago, and for a conference, and I happened to be chatting with the present chief of the Cochin shipyard. And he was relating to me that when Cochin University opened up its first course for naval architecture, and the Cochin University opened it up soon after independence because we needed, it was the government of India, the defense ministry looked at having some, we needed to train people to build boats for the defense. And the professor was from Germany, East or West, I don't remember. And he stayed on campus. He came only for 6 months, but he stayed for about 5 years or so. He was teaching the students. And when he came to know about this, the wooden ships being built in Mandalay or in Kerala coast near Kananu, he poo-pooed the idea. He was an absolutely Western-educated engineer and scientist, but he was open enough to engage with them. And he gave them a problem saying, okay, this is what I want you to do. I want this boat to be going in this direction, latitude, longitude, blah, blah. And what would the specifications be? And, the specifications, he says, modern engineers would require a lot of computers and calculations. But he took one pencil and paper and wrote something like hieroglyphics. And he came out with an answer which was very, very close to the last second or third decimal point that the professor had worked out. So this is a skill that we are ignoring. This is a skill that we need to utilize. As you in many, many traditional arts, it's a learning of generations. It's a learning of many years. And we are trying to replace that learning with just 3 or 4 year degree program. So how do we bridge this gap is a key. These are some things we need to address. All is not lost, but it will soon be lost if we don't give them an opportunity to be talking to us. So, Commodore Johnson, sorry I intervened, but I was absolutely fascinated by these. I'm yet to go to Baypool, that's the one on the Kerala coast. But the one in Mandalay, I was on a vacation when I said, okay, I had half a day to kill, so I said, let's go and see these boats. And anybody who goes that side to Kutch has to see this to believe what can be done. For me, a wooden boat till that moment was just a rickety, raggedy, some fishing boat which goes along the coast. But when I saw this, I was absolutely amazed. I think, we should make this more interesting for students by a quiz program or something. So if I ask the, listeners, I'm sure they would be in the same position I was before I visited this as to what, I mean, how big do you imagine this boat to be? Even the pictures don't give you an idea. You have to have a picture of a human being next to the ship, and only then you'll get an idea. These are 1,000 tonners. They are not small. This is a very fascinating area, and I'm sure there will be people interested in knowing more. Thank you for giving me an opportunity to intervene and share my thoughts. Thanks. You're muted, Commodore. You're still muted. Sir Ramesh, I request you to take over.
Will do, madam. Thank you. Commodore Johnson, sir, do you have some problem unmuting? Can you speak now? No, you are still not audible. Yeah, it shows unmuted to me. Now, can you see? Johnson, sir, can you speak? Sir, what Sripad says that you connect, try to reconnect. In the meantime, I'll take one more question. This is from Mr. Muthukumaran, who is an archaeologist. And he is asking the speakers whether they have any information about Izadi excavation and Pumpahar and Cholas. You've had so much of talk on the west coast, whether any works on the east coast. One is Pumpahar, of course, and then of course even in the Kalinga side, in Orissa side also, there would have been a lot of shipbuilding and and the forts on the east coast, are there any forts really worth, of course the Marathas had so many forts and other things built up on the west coast. What about the east coast forts? Any ideas on this? Any thoughts?
May I?
Yeah, please.
To my knowledge, when we talk about maritime archaeology and the sites on east coast, there are many sites like Chilika Lake, which is near in Orissa, and there are many more I mentioned, but to deal with them, it needs a lot of time and we had time constraints. But yes, there are many sites like Pumpahar, then Chilika Lake, that was very important site which I know. We got a lot of ingots, iron ingots there. Then even right now, at least few names I come across is Pumpahar and all. And to talk about forts, especially what I have read is the eastern coast has sandy coastal region, so it is less favorable for erection of forts as compared to western coast. So, and plus my what all I work, I have worked on western coast. I belong to Konkan, so I have read much about western coast, but honestly speaking, my knowledge to eastern coast is not that expert. I don't have that expertise to talk about it, but this is what I came through, that the eastern coast is a bit sandy in nature. So this might be the reason that we have less number of forts east on the eastern coast. And I don't know about Maratha forts on the eastern coast as well.
Okay, Amrita, anything on the shipbuilding part of the eastern coast? We all know Bepor and Mandvi are the most famous because they are still existing. Like we still find some remnants happening there. Eastern coast is completely died out. Some boats are there which go from Tuticorin all the way to Malé, which are the same wooden boats, but not much on the shipbuilding front, the old ancient shipbuilding front from the eastern coast, especially the Pumpahar times and Kalinga times and even before that. Any updates or any work has been done on that region?
So I have studied mainly on the Western Coast, yeah. But since history, there has been evidences of the Chola expedition and some historic evidences on the Eastern Coast. But I'm yet to study in detail on these points.
Commander Johnson, sir?
Yeah, I hope I'm audible now. Yeah. Okay, so let me combine a few comments and answers at one go. Let me begin by saying the kind of questions and inquiries that have come is exactly what we looked for. And the reality is, when I showed in my thematic address the vastness of the Indian Ocean, I wish I had just shown the vastness of the Indian coastline, and no single scholar can do justice to the entirety of maritime knowledge just of India itself. Now, why am I mentioning this? Is that the aim of this session with just two cases, with a single case study of Mandvi and just one mention of underwater archaeology and three forts. We have gone to 40 minutes and we have triggered query. Even shipbuilding heritage of India will require a 3-day conference just to begin. So that is the whole aim of this initiative. Specific queries are like this. Someone said further reading. If you go to the Maritime History Society website and or even Amazon for the MHS books on forts, Amrita has already mentioned. On boat designs and forms, Professor Arunachalam has worked extensively. The Tondi of Thoothukudi, all along the Coromandel coast, right up to the Kalingans, the entire thing. Admiral Avati with Commander Unnethan and Professor Arunachalam in 97-98 traveled to these sites, including Bepur. And that is just brief. Much more needs to be done, and I'm going to comment on that just in a minute. But let me come to forts. And there is a reason I'm coming to forts. Thankfully, there is ICOM, the Institution for Conservation of Monuments. Now, they have taken the two specialists. Amrita is a conservation architect. She has studied 7 years of architecture to do this brief presentation. You know, similarly, Aishwarya has worked with ASI and studied archaeology for a long period of time. So on built heritage, we have, thanks to ICOM, there is a system where there is a method of conservation, there is a method of preservation, whether it is ASI, whether it is structures, we have a system. So you're allowed to retain and people can live in a conserved place, and we have some system. But cultural heritage preservation under the United Nations conventions or the Indian rules sadly miss out nautical skills that the Honorable VC was mentioning. Now, shipbuilding, if you go to Bepur, she was saying there is no engineering drawing. The Maestri, they met Satyan Maestri. He just sings the song in his head and he's got a point. So I have a simple model, like conservation on the built heritage has happened. In textile industry, handicrafts have been given an official medium. A handicraft cloth you are permitted to wear. It is not illegal. Khadi is legal. Handicraft handlooms are legal. Why can't we under the shipping? This is not my point. This is Admiral Avati had mentioned it 15 years ago. Give the shipbuilding heritage constructors a special dispensation similar to the handicraft industry or Craft Association of India with certain safety provisions and recognize them like India has given what the VC was mentioning that you can give them recognition. Where safety is involved, by the way, they carry modern gadgets. You can carry a GPS, you can carry an EPIRB. Their safety regulations are far more stringent than what we would recognize. So if we use things like this workshop to say heritage to be maintained can balance the knowledge of the past with the safety of modern times, and we can create a good ecosystem where both can go along. Why don't we make it mandatory for tourism and culture, you must take an ancient craft. Why do we have to take a modern fiberglass boat, which is okay for a safe? Why don't we take this? You know, that boat costs a few crores to build. And if it were not for some families at Qatar, there would be no Bepur Urus being built. If it were not for some rich families in Kutch who are to do trade of onions with the Gulf, the Lepchas or the Mandvi boats will not be built. Why don't we promote under Atmanirbhar Bharat? We actually make that each coastal state make an iconic local boat and use it. That is one of the ways, and we will develop, as the scholars develop, we will put this as one of the workshop ideas. You can make heritage practical. You know, those boats are very real. They are built in modern times. But today they use modern tools in olden style. So it is not that. So that is the best takeaway. It's already 12:05. I don't want to go more. I just want to compliment both Aishwarya and Amrita being practitioners, and with a little bit of effort, they are also now academics in their own right. So, Mr. Ramesh, that's all from our side. These are some valuable takeaways, and we'll put it down into the concept paper that we are looking for the entire initiative of maritime history going forward.
Thank you, Commander Johnson, for this beautiful summation and the way forward. Yes, I fully agree with some of the ideas posed, saying that yes, the tourism industry should be the ones to take up this traditional boats. The only thing which is probably going against these traditional boats is the environmental issues relating to the wood being, you know, being a material for these traditional boats. Wood means cutting of trees and things like that. So that is probably the only issue, and that's probably the why the fiberglass has come in. Of course, one thing is to be mentioned, it's much much more environmentally friendly to dispose of a wooden boat.
You answered the point.
A fiberglass boat. But these the very divergent views will keep happening, and we must definitely encourage. We did try to document some of the traditional boat building practices. The fishermen and the fishing boat builders, the maestris, they don't have a drawing, or they don't make any 3D
they don't need one.
And when we tried to, we wanted some boats which are out of the water, we took a laser scanner to see the hull form and see its characteristics. It was difficult. And they would not allow us to also to come in because they were afraid that we were. So this fear, when academic people or when government institutions come and approach them, there's a fear that we are trying to intrude and probably impose some rules on them and things like that. That is another fear which we have to slowly ask those people to cooperate with us. Then definitely what you have said will help us in a long way in preserving that heritage and that knowledge. The other thing there, I am sure the documents which you have mentioned of Professor Arunachalam and all would have definitely touched upon. There must have been the science of building of these ships would have been documented in the Veda somewhere, Rig Veda, something would have been there. I don't know whether
no I sorry to interrupt, but the reason is the Indian knowledge system in its core nature is a very oral tradition. There is a preservation of knowledge and there is information. It's instead of documenting, the maestri is not randomly building. The song that he sings has sutras. It's like Vedic mathematics. In Vedic mathematics, Sankarvya, Purnabhyam, Apurnabhyam, you can bring that. So there are sutras within that, but that's a very family knowledge, because loss of knowledge meant loss of recognition by sovereign and loss of power. So in a process, when he's not finding his young, like when Amrita met the elderly Shivji Bhai, His children are not likely to take up boat building and the tradition will die. So slowly there is an openness coming. So even in the Vedic components, there is a lot of, lateral interpretation required, which gradually is happening. This we are doing even in the nautical tradition. It's a work that MHS is doing very early days. The Kachi Pothis have got phenomenal content. Dr. Ashok Raj Shirke has done the translation. So there is work, and I think it's a process of collaborative study. They will start sharing. So it's a way forward. And I think we are at least talking about it and staying engaged. And there will be young scholars who will want to spend time with them and understand by first being friendly with them. You know, saying we are not coming as threat, but we want to be part of you. And like other crafts, I'm sure as more young people interact and find, they will find creative ways to interpret and do it. I'm sure things will go well.
Thank you, sir. There are some more questions. One or two comments are there, which I would like to read out. One, Dr. Deepesh Karmakar has commented saying that excellent presentation. Thanks. Whenever I think of maritime heritage, I feel that the geographical site and physical landforms also need attention as our natural heritage. For instance,
totally
agree. Cannot think of a coastal fort without the coast itself. And so protecting the coast from erosion is a component of the conservation of a coastal port as a heritage.
Absolutely.
We have lost and are losing maritime heritage due to natural degradation. So combining the two under the wider umbrella of heritage will act as complementary to both the conservation of geographical sites and landforms as well as the maritime heritage itself.
Couldn't agree more. Dipesh is a very good geographer and a friend. And as a navigator, I agree. As I said, maritime history is a very multidisciplinary approach. So we will require to look at every element. Agree.
Thank you. And there are other questions again, which keep coming about asking for literature help and mainly. And of course, one of our own students who has been a bit of an interest in the maritime heritage is Pawan Suman Joshi.
Yes, I am keen to meet him.
He's actually put in a question saying that the history that is documented, apart from creating just awareness and knowledge base, should actually be put in use. He's trying to create a mathematical or a statistical model by taking various technological developments into time domain, present highs and lows, and thus give best possible technological, administrative, and social practices that boosted maritime development. I think he is actually going into this kind of
tell Pawan to connect with us in tracing the nautical knowledge of India series in navigation. We are doing this lateral, what is called cylindrical back channel study, and a lot of mathematical modeling is required. We'll be very glad at MHS to trigger him into at least some of the modules of that research. IMU could connect him with us, and we'll be very happy to facilitate.
Thank you very much, sir. And I think we had an interesting session. So I must thank speakers Amrita and Aishwarya for having dealt with the subject, gone far deep enough for everybody to understand, and especially trigger the response, what is required for us to, to ponder upon and to further elevate ourselves in knowledge of the maritime history. Thank you very much.